poor, yet making many rich, having nothing, and yet possessing everything. Please subscribe to this channel for more videos related to Christian faith. The letters or epistles of Paul were written to various Christian communities and churches he visited during his missionary work. There are traditionally 14 Pauline epistles, but contemporary scholars debate whether Paul was the author of all of them. Next to the four gospel accounts of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Pauline epistles are the second most influential documents of Christianity. Paul's letter to the Romans was most likely written around AD 57. During his third missionary journey, he wrote this letter to the church in Rome and to a community he himself had not founded. Here he teaches about justification by faith and not through the mere observance of the law. He also invokes the principle of the natural moral law. Indeed, when Gentiles who do not have the law do by nature things required by the law, they are a law for themselves. Even though they do not have the law, since they show that the requirements of the law are written on their hearts, their consciences also bearing witness and their thoughts now accusing, now even defending them. Paul reminds the Christian community that all men and women of all creeds and cultures are capable of knowing right from wrong. This capacity to discern basic ethical norms is given by reason to all human beings, and it is accented by those ethical norms common to all cultures and civilizations. Paul does not want the Romans and Christians in general to take their salvation for granted. He claims that living a moral life is the duty of all believers, since even the pagans know rudimentary right from wrong. According to him, Christians not only have the moral law to inform them, but by faith have the love of Christ to motivate them. Paul's message is to trust in God and place hope in Christ. Romans 3 verses 23 to 24 states, "For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Jesus Christ." This became the hallmark of Martin Luther and the Protestant reformers in the 16th century AD. Paul goes on in chapter 4 to explain that Abraham was not justified by works, but Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness. Chapter 5 of the letter to the Romans gave St. Augustine the foundation of his theology of original sin. Therefore, just as sin entered the world through one man, and death through sin, and in this way death came to all men, because all sinned. For just as through the disobedience of the one man, the many were made sinners, so all through the obedience of the one man, the many will be made righteous. Augustine saw the connection Paul was making with the first man, Adam, by which original sin was transmitted to all human beings via wounded human nature, and the second Adam, Christ, who saved all human beings by redeeming human nature. Chapter 8 gives great comfort to Christians during time of trial and tribulation. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Paul may have written his two epistles to the church in Corinth around AD 57. He was the one who established the Christian church there among the Corinthians sometime about 7 years earlier. Concern he addresses are internal division, sexual immorality, marriage problems, paganism, liturgical abuse, and the resurrection of the dead. Where 1 Corinthians is a letter of fraternal correction, 2 Corinthians is a letter of instruction on how to do even better than before, as well as on Paul's love for the community. He addresses concerns like almsgiving, forgiveness, and a self-defense of his ministry and authority. The first issue Paul deals with his divisions within the church. One of you says, I follow Paul, another, I follow Apollos, another, I follow Cephas, still another, I follow Christ. Is Christ divided? Was Paul crucified for you? Were you baptized into the name of Paul? Here he battles the focus on personality and reminds the Corinthians that the preacher or pastor is not the focus, but the message and the Lord Jesus are what should be the center of attention. Then he moves on to sexual immorality. It is actually reported there is sexual immorality among you, and of a kind that does not occur even among pagans. A man has his father's wife. Do you not know that the wicked will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor male prostitutes, nor homosexual offenders, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. His teaching on marriage is found in chapter 7. Now the unmarried and the widows, I say, it is good for them to stay unmarried as I am. But if they cannot control themselves, they should marry. For it is better to marry than to burn with passion. To the married, I give this command, not I, but the Lord. A wife must not separate from her husband, but if she does, she must remain unmarried, or else be reconciled to her husband. And a husband must not divorce his wife. Chapter 11, verses 23 to 25 reiterate the words of the Last Supper and also the very same words spoken at the Christian Eucharistic liturgy. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this, whenever you drink it, in remembrance of me." This follow-up letter is intended to balance the chastisements of the previous with compassion and mercy. He reminds the Corinthians to show forgiveness after a sinner repents. You ought to forgive and comfort him so that he will not be overwhelmed by excessive sorrow. He also repudiates those that question his credentials. In other words, the suffering he has already endured for the gospel. In great endurance, in troubles, hardships, and distresses, in beatings, imprisonments, and riots, in hard work, sleepless nights, and hunger, in purity, understanding, patience, and kindness, in the Holy Spirit and in sincere love, in truthful speech and in the power of God, with weapons of righteousness in the right hand and in the left, through glory and dishonor, bad report and good report, genuine yet regarded as impostors, known yet regarded as unknown, dying and yet we live on, beaten and yet not killed, sorrowful yet always rejoicing, poor, yet making many rich, having nothing, and yet possessing everything. Written between AD 50 and AD 55, this letter is to the community in Galatia, warning them against the attempts of the Judaizers to impose their personal piety on everyone else. The Judaizers were zealous Jewish Christian converts who thought that all Christians should retain the Mosaic Law, especially the dietary regulations and the requirements of circumcision. Paul chastised Peter, Cephas, for allegedly flip-flopping and eating with Gentiles at one moment and then avoiding their table when Jewish Christians came to town. In the letter to the Galatians, Paul gives a partial list of sins that he is concerned about among the Galatians. The acts of the sinful nature are obvious: sexual immorality, impurity and debauchery, idolatry and witchcraft, hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions and envy, drunkenness, orgies, and the like. I warn you, as I did before, that those who live like this will not inherit the kingdom of God. The letter to the Ephesians was probably written around AD 60. By that time, Paul was already imprisoned in Rome. While addressed to the church community in Ephesus, this epistle, like all that are in the New Testament, has global and perennial importance and impact. This letter reminds the reader that the church is an organic unity and not an optional accidental association of individuals. According to St. Paul, the church is the mystical body of Christ, an analogy he uses in more than one epistle. There is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. The vision for Paul is the work of the devil, since God wishes all his children to be one with him. The body of Christ, the church, is not just an institution, but an organic unity. It is a unity within diversity, so that unity does not equate with uniformity. It was he who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, and some to be pastors and teachers. The most controversial passage from Paul's epistle to the Ephesians is, "Wives, submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything." Whenever a scripture passage is taken out of context, you get a pretext. All of scripture is inspired and inerrant, but it must be taken in context with the whole of scripture. This passage only makes real sense when you read the rest of the story. Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. Husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. The complete passage shows that both the husband and wife have obligations to each other. The image of spousal relationship, bride and groom, is characteristic to Paul. He makes the analogy that Christ loves the church as a groom loves his bride. The church is often spoken of in feminine terms, with feminine pronouns, since she is considered the bride of Christ, and Jesus being male is described in masculine terms and pronouns. This same marital relationship was portrayed in the Old Testament covenant of God and the Hebrew people. Chapter 6 describes the proper behavior for children toward their parents and slaves toward their masters. "Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Father, do not exasperate your children. Instead, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord." Another controversial section in these epistles is, "Slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, and with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. Obey them not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but like the slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart, serve wholeheartedly as if you were serving the Lord, not men, because you know that the Lord will reward everyone for whatever good he does, whether he is slave or free. And masters, treat your slaves in the same way. Do not threaten them, since you know that he who is both their master and yours is in heaven, and there is no favoritism with him." Paul is neither justifying nor endorsing slavery. However, slavery at the time was not often as heinous as it was in the New World, when Africans were enslaved and shipped to America. The historical context is one element of accurately interpreting scripture. At the time of Paul, society was patriarchal and imperial, almost akin to the idea of necessary evils in the sense that as a result of original sin, the previous equality of all people of all genders, races, nationalities, and cultures was disrupted. Division and inequality are results of sin. Genesis uses the Tower of Babel to explain why there are different languages in the world instead of just one. The sin of pride destroyed the unity of speech. Paul is also not using the Bible to justify patriarchy any more than slavery. Nevertheless, the historical context, just like the erroneous notion of the geocentric universe, is part of the context of sacred order. An optimistic and upbeat epistle, the letter to the church community in Philippi was most likely meant to show encouragement, despite the fact that at the time, Paul was under house arrest in Rome. His imprisonment was a blessing in disguise. He tells the Philippians, "Since his captivity has given courage and zeal to others to take up the torch and continue evangelizing," he tells them not to worry about his predicament. All his discomfort, pain, and suffering is worth it, since being united to Christ is what gives him real joy. He also warns them not to become complacent, since many of them enjoy the privileges of Roman citizenship, just as he does. It won't save his life nor his soul, but it will be of some advantage nonetheless. One of the most sublime and edifying hymns found in Paul's epistles is in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 5 to 11, which is meant to extol the virtue of humility. As Jesus was humble, even in surrendering some of his divine prerogatives, while not diminishing his divinity, so too the Christian is to seek a life of humility. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Though Paul did not visit nor found a church in Colossae, east of Ephesus, it still was dear to him. He wrote a letter to the Colossians to correct some errors that had been infiltrating their Christian church. The most likely culprits were the Gnostics, who preached a secret knowledge of salvation which contradicted the universal gospel. Their unorthodox teachings diluted some of the Christian doctrines Paul now had to reaffirm. Jesus Christ is true God and true man. He has a real divine nature and a real human nature. He is not half God and half human, but possesses full divinity and full humanity. The central doctrine of Christianity, which distinguishes it from other two monotheistic religions, Judaism and Islam, is the notion of a triune God, one God in three persons. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation, for by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together, and he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness and dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. In his letter to the Colossians, Paul also reiterates his social teaching on family and civil life as found in Ephesians. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not embitter your children, or they will become discouraged. Slaves, obey your earthly masters in everything, and do it not only when their eye is on you and to win their favor, but with sincerity of heart and reverence for the Lord. Here he encourages the Colossians not only to abandon false teachings, but also to embrace and pursue a life of holiness. These two epistles concern the Christian church in Thessalonica, a city in northeast Greece. Paul preached there during his second missionary journey. Acts chapter 17 shows that Paul stayed there just about 3 weeks among the Thessalonians due to the unrest and civil disturbance caused by their enemies in that town. The main thrust of both epistles, however, deals with the second coming of Christ, called the parousia in Greek, at the end of the world. Many of Thessalonians thought the second coming was extremely imminent, so that meant there was little for them to do but wait, and others thought it had already happened and they had somehow missed it. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or who grieve like the rest of men, who have no hope. The early Christians called the dead sleepers, since death was seen as falling asleep and not the final end. Probably the oldest and first of Paul's letters, possibly written around AD 50 to 52. This epistle deals with a doctrine uniquely Christian in origin and meaning, the second coming of Christ. The first coming of Christ took place when he was conceived in his mother's womb and was then born in Bethlehem 9 months later. After his death and resurrection, he ascended into heaven but promised he would return. That return of the risen and glorified Christ is called the second coming or parousia. Paul reminds the Thessalonians that neither the dead nor the living will have advantage over the other at the second coming of Christ. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. The Greek word harpaxometha, used in Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 17, means to be caught up, to be seized, to be snatched up. St. Jerome's Latin Vulgate used the word rapiemur, the root being rapere, from which the English word rapture has its origin. The rapture is a popular teaching among some Christian denominations. In the 18th century, Manuel de la Cunza y Díaz was the first to espouse the doctrine. In the 19th century, it was modified by John Nelson Darby and embraced by Cyrus One, and in the 20th century, by Scofield, author of the Scofield Bible. The doctrine is that prior to the second coming of Christ, there will be a seven-year period of great tribulation, suffering on earth. The saints of Christ, believers, will not experience this great tribulation, since they will be caught or taken up and meet Christ in the sky. Evidently, the first letter was not taken to heart. Some of the Thessalonians still worried that the second coming was so imminent that they stopped working, thinking the end was very near. That meant nothing got done, at home or at work. People did not marry nor have kids, fearing the end was at hand and the world would soon end. If a man will not work, he shall not eat. This was directed at those Christians who no longer went to work. The branches of Christianity that believe in the literal rapture have variations on the event. Pre-tribulational rapture is the notion that the rapture occurs before the 7 years of tribulation. The post-tribulational is that the rapture happens after the tribulation. Premillennialism is the notion that the second coming precedes the millennium. 1,000-year reigns of Christ on earth with his believers. Post-millennialism is that the millennium precedes the second coming. Timothy traveled with Paul since his second journey. His father was a Gentile, but his mother was Jewish, which was why Paul circumcised Timothy in Acts 16, verse 3, to appease the sensitivities of some Hebrew-speaking Christians. These letters contain advice from an old friend on how to refute false teachings and defend the true faith, how to manage the relationships and appoint worthy pastors, deacons, and bishops. Now a bishop must be above reproach, married only once, temperate, sensible, respectable, hospitable, an apt teacher, not a drunkard, not violent but gentle, not quarrelsome, and not a lover of money. He must manage his own household well, keeping his children submissive and respectful in every way. For if someone does not know how to manage his own household, how can he take care of God's church? He must not be a recent convert, or he may be puffed up with conceit and fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must be well thought of by outsiders, so that he may not fall into disgrace and the snare of the devil. Then he gives the qualifications for the deacon. Deacons, likewise, are to be men worthy of respect, sincere, not indulging in much wine, and not pursuing dishonest gain. They must keep hold of the deep truths of the faith with a clear conscience. A deacon must be the husband of but one wife, and must manage his children and his household well. Paul also warns about worldliness. Many Christians became complacent when they also become successful. He never advocated a total and radical poverty as a precondition to the spiritual life, and in fact, he is often misquoted. The saying, "Money is the root of all evil," is inaccurate quotation. What Paul did say to Timothy was, "For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil." Paul uses three Greek words, episkopos, bishop, diakonos, deacon, and presbyteros, priest or elder, for three offices of spiritual leadership in the church. Catholicism, Eastern Orthodoxy, and the Anglican churches see these as three tiers of the sacrament of holy orders. Titus was a Gentile Greek convert and a traveling companion of Paul around AD 63 to 64, and after Timothy stayed in Ephesus, Paul and Titus continued to Crete. Titus remained to establish the Christian church while Paul continued his missionary journey. Philemon was a prestigious and well-respected Christian in Colossae. Philemon's epistle is a personal letter from Paul addressed to him concerning his runaway slave, Onesimus. Paul asked Titus to take care of some unfinished business, namely to select, appoint, and ordain local leaders, bishops, and priests. The bishop would be in charge of the larger area, while the priest or elder would be the equivalent of a local neighborhood pastor, as there could be several or more in one town. An elder must be blameless, the husband of but one wife, a man whose children believe and are not open to the charge of being wild and disobedient. Paul warns, do not be hasty in the laying on of hands. The laying on of hands is synonymous with ordination. The gesture is an invocation of the Holy Spirit upon the person, but when done by the bishop, it is part of the ordination ritual to the episcopacy, diaconate, or priesthood. It is a Christian sacrament, like baptism and the Eucharist. The bishop, on the other hand, has more qualifications to fulfill, since he has a larger responsibility. Since an overseer is entrusted with God's word, he must be blameless, not overbearing, not quick-tempered, not given to drunkenness, nor violent, nor pursuing dishonest gain. Rather, he must be hospitable, one who loves what is good, who is self-controlled, upright, holy, and disciplined. He must hold firmly to the trustworthy message as it has been taught, so that he can encourage others by sound doctrine and refute those who oppose it. While sounding a little jaundiced, Paul warns Titus about the local recruits from which to appoint bishops and priests. Even one of their own prophets has said, "Cretans are always liars, evil brutes, lazy gluttons." Onesimus was a slave who belonged to Philemon and then escaped. He fled to Rome and wound up in jail with Paul. Onesimus embraces the Christian faith while imprisoned with Paul. Paul now writes to Philemon asking him to take Onesimus back, but not to mistreat, abuse, or punish him for his escape. He may have even stolen some money from Philemon, in which case Paul tells the owner to charge it to his account instead. If he has done you any wrong or owes you anything, charge it to me. In ancient times, an escaped slave could be brutally beaten, abused, or even killed. Since Onesimus was now a believer and Philemon had been one for a while, Paul counted on his Christian sense of mercy. He did not, however, ask for his emancipation. Scholars continue to debate as to the identity of the author and the intended audience of the epistles to the Hebrews. Some maintain it is Paul who wrote it. Others say it is one of his students. Some say it was written for Jewish converts before the destruction of the Temple of Jerusalem in AD 70. Others claim it was written afterwards. Martin Luther hypothesized that Apollos was the author. Tertullian thought it was actually Barnabas, while Clement of Alexandria and Origen credited it to Paul. The Epistles to the Hebrews contain highly developed theology on Christ, known as Christology, especially the notion of Jesus Christ as the eternal high priest. Paul explains that Jesus Christ is the new high priest, not by birth. He was of a different clan and tribe, but by election. That is, God the Father chose him. Secondly, his priesthood is not symbolic. John the Baptist calls Jesus the Lamb of God. On the cross, Jesus was both the priest who offered the sacrifice and the victim being sacrificed. Paul makes the analogy of Melchizedek, king of Salem and priest. Unlike the hereditary Levitical priesthood, Melchizedek is priest by nature, not by birth. He offers up bread and wine, just as Jesus did at the Last Supper. Paul quotes Psalm 110, "You are a priest forever, in the order of Melchizedek." Formerly priests were taken from among men who were weak, imperfect, and sinful, and so the sacrifices they offered on behalf of the people, they also offered for their own sins as well. Jesus, being the Son of God, has no sin and therefore does not offer up sacrifice for his behalf, but totally for our benefit. The sacrifice is not something symbolic like a lamb. It is his very own life, which Jesus sacrifices on the altar of the cross at Calvary. Now, if perfection had been attainable through the Levitical priesthood, for the people received the law under this priesthood, what further need would there have been to speak of another priest arising according to the order of Melchizedek, rather than one according to the order of Aaron? For when there is a change in the priesthood, there is necessarily a change in the law as well. Now the one of whom these things are spoken belonged to another tribe, from which no one has ever served at the altar. For it is evident that our Lord was descended from Judah, and in connection with that tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. It is even more obvious when another priest arises resembling Melchizedek, one who has become a priest not through a legal requirement concerning physical descent, but through the power of an indestructible life, for it is attested of him, "You are a priest forever, according to the order of Melchizedek." The author of Hebrews points out that the priesthood of Christ is eternal. A priest is one who offers sacrifice to God on behalf and in the name of the people. The Old Testament priesthood was imperfect but symbolic, as it pointed out to the real priesthood of Jesus, which would not be symbolic. That is, there is no animal sacrifice, but the very Son Himself is sacrificed in atonement for our sins and those of the whole world. His sacrifice actually atones, redeems, and saves human nature. Please go to YouTube Retirementality Channel playlist Bible Studies for the complete series of these introductory materials.